It's made me sleep and I eyes off peacefully. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. I want us to begin to appreciate God. Give God the glory, give God all the honor. Father, we thank you. We appreciate you. You are so good. You are so kind. We lift you high. We magnify your name. We lift you high today. You are the beginning of all things. You are the end of all things. Let's just appreciate this, our good God, our Father in heaven, the never changing, the never failing God. Just go ahead and begin to exalt him, Daddy. We exalt your name. We magnify you because of who you are. Marianga Boseka, Tayandrebo Supreningeboseka, Mekataka Yandarabanga, Tazika Yendrebo Supremangaba, Mandriba, 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 name, we have prayer. I want us to listen to this song together. We have lifted him up with Don Moen's music. This hour, I want us to just exalt him once again. It is not enough to praise God. And I like the instruction that came to us today is that we should praise God today. We're going to take this song together. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Hallelujah.
With a melody, you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies. Till all my fears are gone, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again to your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Hallelujah.
I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave of fear. I am a child of God. Ooh, oh, oh, oh. I am a child of God. I am a child of God. I am a child of God.
Hallelujah. We are no longer a slave for fear. We are children of God. For that cause, I want us to just appreciate God, give God the glory. You are no longer subjected under fear. The Bible says Jesus Christ came to set free those who are held captive to bondage through fear. But you are no longer under bondage. Can you just go ahead and just be to exalt God? Give him the glory and honor and majesty that he deserves. Father, thank you because your truth will make us free today again. We have come before you to learn at your feet. Daddy, we pray, Lord, that you take from Jesus and show unto us in the name of your dear Holy Spirit of God. We ask that you break the word open to us today. Let our eyes be open in Jesus' most precious name. We have prayed. I tell you, God is visiting us again. Therefore, I want to welcome you all, especially to this conference. I know God has great plans for you. I know you are not here by accident. It's not by accident that you are attending this conference today. It's not by accident that you have been invited. It's not by accident that you're a part of the team that is putting this program to task, put this program together. It is not by accident. God has a unique purpose for making you and I to be a part of this conference. God is in the business of making us to find him. And the Bible says, we shall search for him with all of our heart. We will find him. I pray today that you and I will find God in the mighty name of Jesus. I want you to turn with me once again today to Jeremiah in chapter 29 as you pray. Jeremiah 29. You are welcome in Jesus' name. Please share the link with as many people as possible. It's the same link that we used yesterday that we're using today. Share the link with all your friends, colleagues, people on your place of work, all that are connected to you. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13, the scripture says, and you shall seek me and find me when you shall search for me with all your heart, and I shall be found of you. What is this saying? As long as you can seek, you will find. And remember what the Lord Jesus said in the book of Matthew. He said, he that knocketh, the door shall be opened. He that seek shall find. Those that are hungry and thirsty for righteousness shall be filled. You have to pray and say, Father, I've come to meet with you today. Father, help me to find you. Help me to find you. Find myself. Father, in line of my career, my purpose, and find what you are saying relevant to my career, relevant to my career, relevant to my purpose. In the name of Jesus, can you go and read the top of Father, help me to find it today. I've come to seek you, Father. Help me to find you. Marikata seka yandiribakata. Marabuse kata yandiribakata. Mirabakata kata kata. Mirabakata kata kata yandiribaha. Marabakata kayeka buse kata yandiribaha. Father, help me to find you. Help us to find you. At this conference, Lord, help each and every one of us to meet with you. Marika buse kata yandere busu pravangaba. Me kata 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 kata. Masika yandere busu bringe bu bringe bu bringe bu bringe bu ha. Me kata kayandra ba ha. Mandra ba 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 ha. Reka ba 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 ha. Masika yandra ba ha. Mandra ba ha. Reka ba 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 ha. Mariki ba busa kata yandere ba kata sika. Me kata kasuka yandere busa ta. In Jesus' most precious name, we have prayed. In the book of Matthew in chapter 13, Matthew chapter 13, I want us to look at it. I'm going to read verse 44. It says, again, the kingdom of heaven will be like unto treasure, hid in a field, which when a man has found, he hideth it. And for the joy thereof, goeth and selleth all that he has, and buyeth that field. The kingdom of God will be likened to a treasure that is hidden in a field. That when a man come across it and find it, he will hide it very well. Then go and sell everything he has so that he can purchase that treasure. Because having that treasure will make you to have everything. I remember the man of God, Bishop David Oyedepo, was speaking. He said, God is all you need to get all your need met. God is all you need. God is all you need. God is all you need to get all your needs met. So if you can find God, I tell you, you can find everything. I want you to pray and say, Father, help me to find you. Help me to find you. In this meeting, oh God, that hidden treasure, Father, let it be released unto me in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth, begin to talk, God. Father, I pray. Lord, help me to find you, oh God. Father, Lord, help me to find you. That hidden treasure. Hidden, oh God, reveal it to me in the name of Jesus. Marekata saka yandere busubringa busaka. Mekataka yekata 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 yekata. Maseka yandere busubringa baha. Rekabakata kayandere bakata. Masuke yandere busubringa baha. In Jesus' most precious name, we have prayed. I want you to turn with me to Job chapter 22. I'm going to read from verse 21. It said, acquaint now thyself with him. And be at peace. Therefore, good shall come unto thee. Receive, I pray thee, the law from his mouth, and lay up his word in your heart. If thou return to the Almighty, thou shalt be built up. Thou shalt put away iniquity far from your tabernacle. Then shalt thou lay up gold as dross. I want you to look at that. And the gold of Ophir as the stone of the brooks. Yea, the Almighty shall be thy defense, and thou shalt have plenty of silver. When you acquaint yourself with God, how do you acquaint yourself with God? By seeking him. By seeking him. He said, you will seek me and find me. Acquaint yourself with the Lord so that you can lay up silver as dust. So when you have dust that you beat out, it has actually silver. You can enjoy the gold of Ophir when you acquaint yourself with God. What does it mean to acquaint yourself with God? Seek him. Go all out for him. And God's servant said, like I said, God is all you need to get all your needs met. So if you find God, you will find yourself. You will discover yourself. And in discovering yourself, I tell you, you will enter into the fullness of all. Your life will be fulfilled. You will live fulfilled life. You will live a fulfilled life. He said, God is all you need. God is all you need to have all your needs met. God is not in need. He is in a mission to meet your need. So this program is all about God meeting your need, giving you direction, showing you the way to go, explaining things to you. Because the greatest sin, the greatest crime you can commit to, tragedy that a lot of people have gone through at the moment is the fact that they find themselves in the wrong field. They find themselves laboring where they're supposed to minor, and minor where they're supposed to major. You're going to pray and say, Father, I choose to acquaint myself with you. That's a seek ye first the kingdom of God and the righteousness, then every other thing shall be added. You're going to pray and say, Father, I've chosen to acquaint myself with you. Father, help me to find you. And in finding you, help me to find myself. In finding myself, help me, Lord, to discover all that you have for me. In the name of Jesus, open your mind to pray, Father, in the name of you, I've chosen, oh God, to acquaint myself with you. I've chosen, oh God Almighty, to seek you first. Lord, I've come to seek you. Father, reveal yourself to me. Father, help me to find you. Help me to find myself. Help me, oh God Almighty, oh Lord, to find, oh Lord, and discover your plan, your purpose, what you are saying concerning my career, what you are saying concerning my purpose. In the name of Jesus. Masika yandrebo sobrama. Mikataka yandrebaba. Rakanta yandrebo subraningaba. Manderebo subraningebo skata. In Jesus' name we pray. Last year, I'm going to pray. He said, in that verse 21, he said, acquaint yourself with the Lord and be at peace. Therefore, good shall come unto you. I want to tell you, there is nothing you want. Is it peace of mind? Is it the right career? Is it a flourishing life? What is it that you want that God cannot give you? God is not telling you, give me money to give you. No, he's only saying, seek me. Seek me. Seek me. And what it does mean to me is God, to seek him in spirit and truth. To seek him with all of your heart. In that Jeremiah that we first read, he said, and you will find where you shall search for me with all of your heart, which means God can be found. You're going to pray today and say, Father, anoint my eyes with eyesight. Help me to see even beyond even the written code in the name of Jesus. Help me to see as I ought to see. Open my eyes and make my eyes with eyesight in the name of Jesus. Father, open our eyes today. Daddy, anoint our eyes with eyesight. Help us to see today. Help us to encounter you today. Help us to encounter you, Lord, as your servant will be ministering. Even during the question and answer time, Father, Lord, even paraphernalia, there might be quiz, let your will be done. Help me to see you. Help me to see you. Help me to see you in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. What are the expectations that you have? I want you to leave before go 1 minute, 60 seconds, just go ahead right now. Begin to present your expectation. Maybe you are seeking for clarity in one area or the other. Remember, the healing power of God is still in the house. His power is present. But Jesus was in a certain place, he was speaking, and the power of God was available. Mikata kayike pose kata yendribaha, mekatoske yandribaha, raboska yandribaba, mekata, mekata, rekaba babaha, masukata yendribo supraningabaha, mekatuske yandribaha, marakanta kayendribo subraba, mekata kata, masuka yandribaha, mekata kasuntraba. Father, we thank you. Lord, we bless your name. We magnify your name. Thank you for another time in your presence. Thank you, Lord God Almighty. We bless your name. We magnify you. Thank you, Ancient of Days. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayer. We're going to state, I stand in awe of you by Bob Fitts. I will invite God's servant. Today is the day two of the conference. Tomorrow will be the grand finale. You can afford to miss it at New Wine Church tomorrow night, between 9 and 12 in the morning. We'll be there, and God is going to move mightily in our midst and begin to experience God in a new way. Today's session is taken by Pastor Paul Olashire. Without wasting time, I'm going to invite him to take us on this session. But as we continue, I want us to take this song. The song that I really want us to sing is Draw Me Close to You. You are all I have. Once, draw me close to you. We're going to sing along this music. You are all that I ever need. Draw me, draw me, draw me, draw me close to you. There is a cry in our heart. Lord, draw me closer, draw me closer, draw me close to you, oh God. Draw me, help me to meet with you. We're just going to take this song together. Can we just listen to it now? Hallelujah.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. You are welcome this evening for another time of God's mercies and goodness. We thank God for the privilege He's given to us to be here this evening. And we thank Him for the privilege to receive in His presence this evening. I want you to ask Him specifically to position you for the best that He has in store for us as His children, and the best that He wants to give to you in this particular season that we are in. And I want you to also tell Him, I want the best you have for me. I want the best you have for me. I want you to do that quickly in just 1 minute. Let's do that. Let's ask Him for the best that He has in store for us, you know, and His goodness in our lives. I want us to do that quickly in just a minute. Thank you.
You see the best that you have for us. Masika yandora bosheka tarabu seke tiribaka seka. Mika tasaka yandora baka saka yandora bosheka traba. Daddy, we receive the best that you have for us in the name of Jesus. Mika taka 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 taka. Maraka buska taka yandora bosheka taka yandora baka buska taka yandora baba. Mandora baka taka 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 taka. In the mighty name of Jesus, we receive the best that you have for us. In the
right, we give all the praise in Jesus' mighty name. We are prayed. Father, we thank you for the privilege you've given to us. Thank you for the opportunity to receive in your presence again tonight. We ask, O Lord, that you would give us clarity and give us understanding. We give you glory and praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Hallelujah. Now, one of the greatest things that we have to deal with, particularly in this, our journey through this planet, is the issue of identity. Who am I? What am I? What am I wired for? What am I designed for? You know, how will I be able to succeed as God wants me to? You know, what are the things that are the requirements for a successful life? You know, what are the things that God wants me to get into? Identity is a very, very, very important thing. And there are so many things that are coming up, and we need to understand, you know, our place and be able to get to position accurately for what God has in store for us. All right? So knowing who I am is very vital. Tomorrow we're going to be having the physical session. And if you are in London or UK, you need to be there, because we're learning things in these virtual sessions. But in the physical session at the Gateway House, New One Church, the Mitre Hall, tomorrow, 9 a.m. to 12 noon, we're going to actually position ourselves for some encounters that will transform our lives. All right? There's a very important statement that I make. Now, today, we're looking at finding God to meet you so that you can find your path in life, your path, career path, work path, business path, what you're wired for. And it's important for you to find yourself, you know, because some people are in the field where they are. They are square pegs trying to enter round holes. Some other people in the field where they are round pegs trying to fit into square holes. You know, it's going to be a little bit difficult, even though they may be able to go in, but they will not be able to fit in accurately. And the reason is because I've just not positioned myself where I truly belong. I'm occupying a space that is not mine, a space that is not designed for me, and all of that. And these things are very important, all right? They're very important to success. They're very important to, you know, achievements and all of that. Now, it is very vital for us to know that God has designed that you succeed. God has designed that you be on top of whatever he has called you and wired you for, all right? And it is also very important to know that you are wired for something. You are not just there. You are not just in existence. God wired you for his purpose, for his will, and for his counsel, and you need to find out what that is. Now, what is most important about identity, all right, is to understand that whatever you are and whoever you are is a dimension of God himself. In the book of Genesis, I would like to pick up from there. And this is where I'm going to start tomorrow. And then we're going to come into that place of encounter. In Genesis, in chapter 1, the Bible was speaking in verse 26. And 27, the Bible says, God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over all the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. I need to say a prayer right now. Father, as we share tonight, I pray that each person that has joined now and that will be joining will be accurately connected to you and accurately connected to where and what you have designed and wired them for, so that they can be fully expressed and fully released to enjoy the goodness that you have for them on this side of heaven. Thank you for doing this, Lord. I'm grateful. In Jesus' name, amen. My prayer is that you'll be perfectly connected by the end of this session. You understand? And connected so that for some people, you need to migrate from wherever you are to where God wants you to be. For some people, you have to just make some little shift and then you begin to soar. And you are soaring in the name of Jesus. So in verse 27, the Bible says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. Now, it's also important for us to understand that the God that we serve is omnipresent, meaning he can be present in many places at the same time. The God that we serve is also infinite in his characteristics, in his formation, and in his qualities. For example, everything about him is in multiples. In the book of Revelation, when the Bible was describing the voice of God, you know, there was a time that when Jesus spoke, he said his voice sounded like the voice of many waters. Why? Because all different dimensions of him were manifesting at the same time. And it's important for us to see that. In the book of Revelation, in chapter number 4, when he was describing what was coming forth from the throne of God, I'm going to read just verse 5. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings, not one light, many light. Each of these light are different dimensions of God. It's like God in multiple forms. It's like many gods manifesting at the same time. I'm not surprised that the Indians have 300 million gods, you know, because somehow maybe they got confused that this one God, you know, is many gods. Do you understand? You know, and it's because of the different dimensions of God Almighty. Now, so he said lightnings. Then he said thunderings. Thunderings is symbolic of his power manifesting, his power radiating. All right. And then he said voices. So God's voice, but voices proceeding from his throne. Because God is infinite. You can't measure him. He's immeasurable. The Bible says there's no searching of his understanding. There's no searching of his wisdom. He's deeper than the deep. He's higher than the heights. He's bigger than everything. In fact, like I was saying to one of my daughters, God created heaven, which he has made his dwelling place. So heaven itself, which is occupying God now, came out from inside God. So you can imagine it's bigger than heaven. Look at the universe. The universe is so big and so awesome. You know, we have thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of galaxies. They are uncountable. I was listening to a man of God recently who was adding up the number of the angels that were just in the presence of God. And he was saying that they are millions and trillions. And he said they are centillions. Angels all around. Because God is so huge. We have thousands of galaxies. The galaxy we are in alone, the Milky Way galaxy, has over 300 million stars. And one of the stars is the sun that shines unto us every day. And this sun is 1 million times bigger than the earth. The sun that shines is one of the stars. And you know what? Out of the 300 billion stars in our own galaxy, 300 billion stars, The sun is one of the smallest stars in our galaxy and is 1 million times bigger than planet Earth. Now imagine galaxies in thousands and thousands and hundreds of thousands and probably millions of galaxies. That's how, I mean, God is so huge. You can't cage him. You can't put him in a small measure. And what he has done is this. He has put an image of himself in each creation of his, particularly each one of us. Every one of us carry an image of God, a complete image of God, because God has several, uncountable. You carry a complete image of God that nobody else carries. And that's why we have discovered that our fingerprints are not the same. All the human beings that have ever lived, no two people have the same fingerprints. You understand? And this thing continues on and on. God just trying to put a stamp and understanding in matter for us. Because the Bible says the things of God can be understood by just looking at his creation, his works. You'll be able to have a measure of understanding of who he is and what he does. So God is very huge and very awesome. And what he has done is that he wants you to be an expression of one of these his images. He wants you to be an expression of it. He wants you to showcase that, to reveal that. That's why you have two identical twins. They're so identical. They look so much the same. But at the same time, when you meet them, you meet two different people having different personality, carrying different auras, carrying different graces, you know, and these things are very, very conspicuous. You understand? Even though you're looking at them physically, you're not able to be able to distinguish them. But when you begin to relate with them, you are able to distinguish them by the image of God that they have and that they reveal. Everyone is the image of God. Now, what exactly is this image of God that you are? What is it? You understand? How do we distinguish the image of God that each one of us is? All right? Now, this image of God is supposed to reveal God. That simply means this, that when you begin to allow that image to manifest fully, you almost be like a God in that area where you are the image of God. You almost be, when we say you be like a God, we're not talking about God to be worshipped or something, but God in terms of certain ways you do things, certain ways, certain things manifest through you. If you look at people who are, I mean, maybe let's take sports stars, for example. Let's take golf. Some of the, I mean, Tiger Woods, you know, is like a lord in the golf game. I think about almost two decades. He ruled that place. Why? He was the image of God in that expression. You understand? And we are all images of God in different expression. And in those areas where we are the images of God, we shine like stars. We shine so bright. We shine so accurately. Now, so what is that image of God? The first is your personality. And we've been talking about that. All right, your personality. And we're not talking about, because when we say personality, that's simply the qualities that form your character. The character of a person now is a combination of one, the core personality of that person that the person was born with, the core personality of that person that the person was born with. It's something that is there, innate in the person. You know, you are born and you are just like that. And you don't need anybody to teach you that, which you are uniquely, you understand? You're just that. It's a combination that God put together by picking some elements from your father, your mother, your grandfather and your grandmother on both sides. And that combination was put together from several ancestors and combined specially to represent a particular image of God, that core personality. You had it right from birth. There are some people that they're just givers. Right from when they are babies, they give to others, they give to others. There are some children, right from when they are babies, they are very aggressive. You understand? You know, you may say that's a negative. It's not a negative. There is actually no negative character trait. They're actually perverse character traits. They could be perverse. They could be put in the wrong direction, put into the wrong things. But if they are put in the right direction, if they are purified and refined, you find the accurate thing. I've seen children. I mean, my wife runs school. It was running a school at one time. And sometimes you go to the daycare session where you have a crèche, and you see certain children manifest. And nobody has taught them how to manifest like that. And they just manifest. There are some of them, they just want attention. Once there's attention, oh, they will make everybody uncomfortable. They will cry and cry and cry. And some children, they just want to be on their own. They just like playing on their own. Some others, they like moving around others. You will see them moving around others, giving this one this, giving little child that has not been taught anything, that has not really gathered any information enough to be able to say, okay, let me form this character. These are qualities that we're born with. I mean, the story of Jacob and Esau, very interesting. One was grabbing the feet of the other, you know, and they called him the supplanter. You understand? That this guy doesn't want this other guy to go. He's like saying, no, 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 I must come out first. You understand? Now, that is something that was already in Jacob right from when he was formed. God said to Jeremiah, look at Jeremiah in chapter 1. Jeremiah chapter 1. Verse number 5. He said, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet to the nation. Now, if you look at Jeremiah as a prophet, very unique prophet. You look at Isaiah, another unique prophet. Each of them, both of them prophets, but each of them carrying a different image of the prophet that God is to their generation. Are you getting what I'm saying? So that's why you are unique. That's why you cannot want to be like somebody. You have to allow somebody to steer you to be fully yourself. And when we say yourself, we're not saying yourself like the world says it, because the world tells you to be your full self, to give yourself to your vices, your weaknesses, and be all of those things. No, that's not what God wants. Why? Because the vices were hardened. They were not things you were born with originally. They might have been some of your core character, but that core character was taught to do something evil, to do something wrong, to be expressed in evil activities, in what we call negative activities. Because the negative activities carry negative waves. And it's clearly seen, even in the realm of the physical, those who study electromagnetic, they see it, that this is a negative wave. This is a wave that is destructive. It is not adding to the beauty and the symphony that is in nature and the universe. All right? It's not adding to it. It's creating distortion. And that's how we know. You understand? That's a confirmation. That's why God is the owner of knowledge of right and wrong, because all negativity always create distortion in creation. They always cause confusion in creation. And that is why it's important to find out what is that thing that I am originally, that character qualities that has never left me, that has always been there, not your vices. Somebody cannot say, oh, one of my own quality is fornication. It's sleeping with girls. I like sleeping with girls. No, 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 no. That cannot be you. That is a vice that was added. Now, listen, as we grow, all different things are added to this thing we call character. You know, maybe you grew up with an uncle that used to shout on people, and you're a male, and then every other person in the house is a female, you know, and the woman in the house doesn't shout, but your uncle is always shouting. You are the one that is the only male. It's possible you start learning how to shout on others. You understand? And that may be harder. You may get to school and then you find out that one of your friends who comes from a richer family, you know, used to look down on others and all of that. And then he became your friend and you began to join him to look down on others. And then you pick up that too. And that is added. That is why most people today are full of debris, the debris of things they have picked up, weaknesses, failures, disappointments, betrayals, all kind of things that they have experienced. Those things have been added to their character. So they are a huge debris of wrong things added, hindering their core personality that is deep inside from manifesting fully. That part doesn't leave them. That part is still there. That part shows up from time to time, but there's a debris of other things that are hindering your fullness from manifesting. Now, you know what that does? In the spirit. Now, listen very carefully, because it applies in the spirit and in this physical world. This physical world, I'm trying not to go in a particular direction, you know, but let me just make mention of this. This physical world, all right, is existing in frequencies, all right? There's what is called electromagnetic waves. There are waves and signals. Every thought in us produces energy, sends out signals. And these signals connect with signals that are there in the atmosphere, all right? And everything is existing in a frequency and a signal. Events, circumstances, people, thoughts of other people, you know, all kind of things. And whatever signals that your thoughts are sending out, all right, are the kind of things and events that will be drawn to you. Are you getting what I'm saying? Now, what God has done is that everything that is good in this life that he has set for you, we're already programmed to recognize that core, inner core personality. Now, Satan doesn't want the signal of that inner personality to reach out and call those things and pull in. You understand? So he puts a lot of debris, you know, all kind of wrong things, you know, and then people call those wrong things, that is me. I remember I was hearing one guy that says, you know, I just have problems. You know, even my girlfriend, both of us have agreed that I can cheat with only one person once every month, just one girl every month. You know, I said, what kind of agreement is that? What kind of submission, you understand, to a weakness is that? That's not you. You may call it you, but it's not you. It's something that was added. Maybe an abuse happened somewhere in your past that have turned you to be that. To turn you to a monster like that, to turn you to a beast like that. Somebody says, oh, why are you calling somebody a beast? Are you judging? I'm not judging. I'm just telling you that's not the best of that person. It doesn't matter what the gift in that person is. That gift will not be able to deliver the kind of contribution to the universe, to nature, to this generation like it's supposed to. Because that person has given himself to something that hinders the fullness. I hope I make sense to somebody. Because these are the realities we are living with. You understand? So the core personality has to be found. That's the first image of God. That's why even when we get born again, that core personality is now amplified, or let me say it's resurrected into the dimensions of divinity. So if you are somebody that is naturally quiet and naturally gentle, it resurrects into divinity. You understand? And what God now says to us, children of God, is add to this thing, this core personality, add to it love, because love is the center nature of God. Add to it all the other virtues and qualities of love. When you begin to add, then you begin to have a formation that is divine, a formation that is awesome, a formation that is beautiful. So even though you are the quiet one and she is the outspoken one, both of you are radiating such glory and such beauty, and everybody just likes you for who you are and for how you are, and you are so excellent. So the fact that you are quiet doesn't mean people say, oh, I don't like that one. Or the fact that you're outspoken doesn't mean people say, I don't like that one. Because the qualities of God have been added to beautify this core character. All right? That's the image of God. Now, another thing that is the image of God that you have is your talents, your gifts. These things are very important. These are wirings that helps you to do certain things and be able to perform certain activities or duties or responsibilities more than others. More than others. When they put you in a place, you can perform those things. And like I said, when we say talent, yes, you may say somebody has talent in football or soccer. You may say somebody has talent in basketball. But really, before basketball came, what was that talent called? You understand? And that's why I want us to always view talent from the wiring that makes the person to be able to do well in that thing. The person that plays football, the wiring has to do with his brain, you understand, his legs and his body, you understand? But the key part is his legs. The guy that plays basketball is the brain, his body, and his hands. The key part is his hands, you understand? His hand must be able to get the ball into the basket. The guy playing soccer or football must be able to kick the ball into the goal. You understand? This is how we should view talent. And that's why you must look into yourself and ask yourself, what is that thing that I do easily and better than most people? You may not do it better than everybody on earth, but you do it better than most people. When it comes to writing, do you easily flow in thoughts? And even in writing, you may be somebody that flows in thought in teaching others. So you write academic books, and you may be somebody that flows in telling stories. So you like to write stories and fiction, you understand? Or maybe biographies. You know, it depends on what talent it is. But there is a talent, and that talent is part of the image of God that you are. It's part of the image of God that you are. There's also another thing that is part of the image of God that you are. It's called, we call it special favor. There is a special favor. It's an aura. It's like a natural perfume you wear that draws certain kinds of things to you easily. Easily, more than others. It draws it to you easily. You get into a place, certain things are drawn to you easily. Certain things just come to you easily. Now, it's possible that you have also added some wrong aura, so you attract some negative things. Like some people say, I don't know why I keep having accidents. I said there's something, there's an aura, there's some negative thing. It could have been a curse, a spell, or something you did, or a thought you carry. If you carry a thought of fear, of, I mean, this is a true story that happened. This man was afraid of flying, so he never flew. He began to grow in wealth. He was wealthy, was doing very well. And all his businesses all over Nigeria, it will go by road. He might even get escorts, you know, get a police van and all that, but he will go by road, never fly. Then one day he was on a business trip to the north of Nigeria, and he met one of his old friends. And the guy would say, oh, how are you doing? And they were talking, and the guy would say, oh, I'm leaving for Lagos tomorrow. He said, oh, I'm also leaving tomorrow. He said, ah, so we'll meet at the airport. He said, no, I'm traveling by road. He said, what? You're traveling by road? He said, I don't fly. Why? I just don't fly. I don't do it. He said, oh, come off it. You are afraid? He said, yes. He said, no. It's not that. You have to confront your fear. You know, some people preach towards that. And the guy said, okay, no problem. He's going to fly. Do you know that that was the plane that crashed? That plane crashed. Why will it attract the plane that will crash? Because there was a fear. There has been a fear. You know, when it comes to fear, confronting fear is good. Yes, help children to confront fear and all that stuff. But in this man's situation, it wasn't a confronting of the fear. It was a walking into the fear. The fear, you know, actually led him into the plane that will crash. That's why Job said, the things that I feared have come upon me. That's why the Bible said we should never be in fear. That's why the Bible said Jesus Christ came to deliver us who are subject to bondage through the fear of death. So he came to remove fear from us, to deliver us from it. So that fear put an aura around the man like a perfume, you understand, that was drawing plane crash. And all that was in there was somebody to just convince him to enter one, and it will be the plane that will crash. That's why we can't give room to all these modernization where people are allowed to tolerate phobias. No! Fight the phobia. The word of God has the power to destroy fear. It has the power. It has the power. You understand? Don't accept a phobia as that is me. No! God didn't create an image of fear. You cannot be afraid. The Bible described God as the lion. Jesus Christ as the lion of the tribe of Judah. And the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 28, he said, the righteous are as bold as a lion. You're supposed to be bold, not fearful. We're never to be afraid. All those things are negative things that sometimes Satan, you know, preaches through the narrations of the world and the way the world thinks now, you know, and tells us to accept it. So people have all kind of phobias and they call it, oh, it's just some chemicals that, and some things that are working in your body and that. Let me tell you something, you can change it. Even science is proving now that you can change your genes. You understand? Your genes are not fixed, cast on stone, that they can be changed. Science is saying it, that epigenetics, go and read about it. They are saying it now, that you can create activities that you do repeatedly and form them into habits. And that will begin to send signal through your brain to your cells. And your cells will bring that signal to your genes. And your genes will begin to take that as the new information. And they'll begin to secrete proteins that will now change the formation, the physiology of your body. Listen, God has already said it, that you should not live in fear. That you should not be afraid. Every time an angel appeared to somebody and they were stepping into the realm of fear, the next thing they say is, fear not. And that statement chases fear away. Fear not. Fear not. I am the Lord. Fear not. So these things are who you are. The image of God you carry, your core personality, the gifts in you, all right? The special favor, that thing that draws certain kinds of things to you easily. You understand? It draws it to you. You just have that favor. I know one man, you know, that has this favor where people just give him things on credit. It started with a business that others build to the level he built to in 1 year. People build to that level normally in 5 to 10 years. Within 1 year, I was able to build to that level. Why? Because the money he didn't have, people gave it to him in products. He didn't need to collect loan. Products were given to him. Okay, pay. Before my face, one day I was in his factory and there was a particular scarce raw material, you know, in their industry that everybody was looking for. And somebody brought a big trailer load of the same raw material, packed it in front of his factory and said, Mr. So-and-so, are you interested that we have this? Said, everybody's looking for it. Please bring it in. And he told him, I don't have money to pay. They said, don't worry, we know you. Just take it, pay as you. Before my face, he went to the next factory and told them, can you take half of the truck? I'll take half. And they paid him. He even made money on that. Came and used that to pay those people. Imagine, I'm telling you, that man, wow. You know, somebody told him, he said, I don't know you, but I feel safe with you. Take this product, pay us when you can. And you know one thing? I know also about him. That man, if he's owing you, he doesn't rest until he pays you. That thing is inside him, you know? So the aura, the special favor, we call it special favor. The aura, the special favor he has, also has a character that makes sure that favor continues to work. And that is his steadfastness, his consistency. He will not rest until he has paid you. He does not like that he has given you his word and he will fulfill it, whatever it will take. That's one man that I know that does that, you know, and it's very powerful. Now, so this is part of your wiring. Now, listen, when you now get born again, oh, awesome. You now pick up the core image of God, all right? Because now your spirit, which wasn't born again, which wasn't recreated, which had taken on the nature of Satan, now changes from human spirit to Elohim spirit, now having the full character of God. Now, when you now combine that spirit with the special favors, with the talent, with your core personality, all of God's image is now evolving. That's why tomorrow we're going to be looking at how to stay in his presence and allow the full glory of the image of God that you are to emerge, because the only place where you can get that image to come out in his fullness is his presence. That's why I say it, because it's one of our teaching. God's presence is your natural habitat. That's where your fullness evolves, emerges, when you stay in his presence. So I say it this way: the closer you are and the deeper you go in his presence, the more your fullness, your glory, the excellency of God that you are manifest. The farther you are from God, the more beastly a man behaves. And take a man away from God's presence, you raise a monster. You create a monster. That's what happens. You understand? Because it is when you behold him, we're going to learn about that. Beholding, when you behold him, you begin to change to become the image of him that you are. You begin to change. Bible says, we all with open face, beholding as in a glass. You're going to see how to do that tomorrow. Beholding as in a glass, the glory of God, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of God. Now, all of these things I've described, all right, now walks in a direction, which is very, very important and powerful. And we need to learn. We need to learn. Now, listen, let me break it down a little bit, because now I'm getting to the more practical side. And if you have a question, you can start asking questions now, because I'm going into another side now. All right? Because you need to understand all of this. The image of God you have, your core personality, your talents and gifts, you know, and we said gifts are outstanding talents. Talents that when you stand in the midst of other talented people like that talent, you stand out. That's a gift. And then we now have the gifts of the Spirit. The gifts of the Spirit come after you are born again. Those who are not born again don't ever get this gift of the Spirit. But they can have talents. They can have their core personality and all of that. And that's why if you see someone who is not born again, but is being trained, you know, in an atmosphere that is righteous, and he grows in that atmosphere, and he finds a talent, he finds a special grace, you see them shine. Why do we call stars idols? Because they're like gods in the area of their gift, like I said the other time. But when you look into their lives, you're not wondering, oh, this guy is a total disappointment. Why? Because when he stands in his gift and his office, is, do you understand? We are like in awe of his music. We are in awe of his playing of basketball, playing of football. You know, like I was talking about Messi. That guy didn't just have the talent of soccer and football, the wiring, you know, of his brain and his legs to work together in such a beauty and excellence, that orchestra of movement that makes goals to happen. But that guy, his talent increases by 300%, if not 500%, when he starts running. I watched a couple of his goals that they put together. I mean, many of it, they put it together. I was watching. I said, if I were a coach of a team that is playing against Messi, I will tell them, please don't let him run. Whatever you do, don't let that guy run. Because his control of that football increases by almost 300 to 500% when he's running. You understand? So, and it makes him to look magical, powerful and magical. You see somebody acting too, and then you see they can enter the character in the story. And you know the person, and you say, why is he behaving as if that is the real character? Because it's a talent. It's a gift. And so it makes us to treat them special. And why? Because they are radiating the image of God that they are. Now, they may not know God. They may not be born again. You say, can somebody who's not born again radiate the image of God? Yes, because God has put the stamp of his image on all of his creation. All of his creation, particularly the human beings. Put a stamp of his image there. You understand? The only thing is that if a person never becomes born again in the spirit, his spirit truly changing and becoming an Elohim spirit from a human spirit, he will never, ever. It doesn't matter how excellent you think his talent and his whatever is. He can never, ever be the fullness that God has for him, except his spirit becomes born again. Can never be. So the best that you see of a person that's not born again is not his best. There is another better than the best that is there that couldn't be tapped because his spirit limited him. The unrenewed spirit, the spirit that wasn't the child of God, limited that dimension. The full dimension comes when your spirit becomes born again. Then you can now behold God. And then in beholding him, you are changed into the same image from glory to glory. Let me read that 2 Corinthians. So that somebody will say, Pastor, you don't read any scripture. Just speaking. I've been quoting scriptures, all right? 2 Corinthians in chapter 3, verse 18. He said, but we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of God. All right, so it's very important for us to understand all these dimensions of ourselves. Now, when you now go into, let's say you're doing job seeking, they'll tell you to write your CV, and then you write your CV, your qualification. You went to this school, you did this course, you have this number of years experience at work, you have developed skill in A, B, C, D. You know, but what people don't do, which I tell them to do, and I think some people are doing it these days anyway, is that they don't write their talents, they don't write their core personality qualities, because that's part of what the company is going to be enjoying. They're going to be enjoying the, because some people have your skill, but they can't deliver at your level. Why? Because now you have that skill, that training, but you have a character quality that goes along with that. And then number two, you also have you have talents that you can even apply and see it work and help the company to make more money. There was a young man that was working for a bank, and he had this special favor where women that are older than him just like him. They don't like him negatively. All right. Now, some people may go in the negative, but they don't like him, but it just has this special combination of personality and horror that just appeals them and is attractive to them. You understand? So because of that, a lot of those women were bringing their money to the bank, and they were all market women. When the boy was ready to leave the bank had to sit down and negotiate with him. Because they know that the people are not coming to the bank because of the name of the bank or the services of the bank. It's because of the guy. Is because of the guy. There was one girl that was our account officer in one bank, you understand? And then when she moved to another bank, we followed her. We carried the church account, everything. Why? Because it wasn't the bank we were following. We were following her. She was the one that had the character and charisma and the beauty of our personality that made us, you know, to be drawn to her, and that's why we're in the bank. It wasn't because of the services of the bank, it was because of the person. And you see, that's one of the powers that a lot of people don't see. They don't see that they have some powers like that, and they don't take advantage of it. You need to understand who you are. You need to understand your wiring. You need to understand where you belong. You understand? And these are primary things, all right? There's some other ones which we can talk about in this subject, but we're going to try and use these few things to now look at certain things about life. Now, like I said, if you have questions, you need to ask now before we go further. So let me see if there are any questions here. Okay, they're just expressions. Good, good. All right, good, good. All right, so let's go right ahead. Now, if you have heard of this man called Robert Kiyosaki, all right, we're just going to pick this, and this is what we want to help us to, you know, want to piece some things together and divide some things so we can see some things. And then we want to use that to help you to start praying and looking at certain areas and understanding certain things about yourself and what you're supposed to be doing with your life and where, and so that you can really go to where you will excel. I've said it, that in Africa, we believe, you know, in the act, let me not say we believe, we have seen and experienced the activities of evil. You understand? And they are real. You know, people from other parts of the world may not believe us, but we are the ones living there and we see what has happened and we understand the experiences. They may tell you, we are just, you know, we're just exaggerating and just, you know, overwhelmed by circumstances. No, no, no. It's true things that people have experienced. Women have carried pregnancies for 5 years, 7 years, you know. I mean, you can't, there's no scientific reason why the child should not be born. And then a pastor comes, holds crusade, and all of them gives birth at the same time. Because the powers of darkness and evil are broken. You know, thank God that those things don't happen today anymore. But in the days when evil was really heavy, in the days of people like Apostle Babalola, they had women. My wife's uncle who raised her was in his mother's womb for 2 years. By the time he was born, he already had their teeth, grown teeth. In his mouth, he was ready to eat. To eat meat. When he was born, why? Because the baby had spent 2 years in the belly, and then she went for a crusade, and then boom, she gave birth. Now, listen, these things are real. They're real. So, now the greatest strategy of all these evil powers is to put a person where the person doesn't belong. Why? They'll struggle. It's like putting someone that's supposed to be a medical doctor in engineering. Number one, he won't like the job. Number two, he will never do well there. He will never excel there. It doesn't matter how hard he works. He can never, ever be the best there. He can never. Why? Because it's just not wired for that place. You understand? The image of God that he is not supposed to radiate glory in that place. It's supposed to radiate glory somewhere else. And that's why it's good to find where I belong. Now, the Robert Kiyosaki now gave us the cash flow quadrant. In the cash flow quadrant, imagine a square. I don't have any PowerPoint to show you. Imagine a square and divide the square into four parts. On the left side of the square, E is written, and that means employed, the employed. On the lower part of that left side, S is written, and that's self-employed. On the right side, B is written on top, that's a business person. On the lower part on the right side, I is written. That's the investor. So we have the employed, we have the self-employed, we have the business person, we have the investor. And the man said, society is divided into that. Society today, yes, really is divided into that. We have people who are employed, we have the self-employed, we have the business person, and we have the investor. So you are in one of them, two of them. It's really tough to see you in three of them, but it's possible, you know. But what this is saying is that some people are employed, some people are self-employed, particularly professionals, architects, doctors, you know, accountants, you know, many of them. They run their firm, run their consultancies, you know, and all of that. They're self-employed. Then it's possible that a self-employed system could become a business. A business is building business. You have a board of directors, a management team, and all of that. That's a business, and the business is running and it's making money. There are shareholders and all of that stuff. And then you have the investor. The investor doesn't do anything. He sends his money to work for him. All right? Now, what is God's will and God's plan for all of us? God's plan for you is ownership. Very important. God's plan for you is ownership. God wants you to own things. You understand? Look at Genesis. You say, if God's plan is ownership, if we all own things, who is going to be working? Don't worry. Some people can own things and still be working. Why? Because that is their wiring and they have assignment, which is purpose. And that's the other thing I didn't mention about the image of God. I'm not going to bring that in, which is purpose. You know, so it's possible for me to have investments in agriculture. And then I have purpose in acting. So I'm still getting jobs in acting. So I'm like self-employed, you know. So I get jobs, I go and act, and then I put investments in agriculture. And so I'm an investor in agri, and I have great investment there, a lot of money coming in there. You know, what is coming in there is like maybe 100% or 1,000%, whatever I make in acting, and I'm still doing that, and I'm still acting. So it's possible, you know, to still have employed and still have investments, all right? Now, so in Genesis chapter 1, in verse number 28, he said, and God blessed them. Oh, thank you for putting that. I don't know who did that anyway, so whoever did it, thank you for doing that. So you have ES, B, and I. That's the investor. The investor is on the right there below. The business person is on top. The employed is on top on the other side and the self-employed on the other side. All right, so we'll go on with that. So he said, God blessed them and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply. Replenish the earth, all right, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. God's desire is that you be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth with your presence. Something from you is supposed to fill this earth, whether it's a business, whether it's an invention, a creativity, something from you should fill the earth. And he said, have dominion, subdue it. When God formed the nation Israel, because ownership was still his plan, God told them, when you get to the land of Canaan, divide the land to everybody. Every family must have land. Every individual must have a portion in the family land. Then God now set up a rule called Jubilee. If you read the book of Leviticus, you see the Jubilee, all right? And in the year of Jubilee, the Bible said every land will return to its owner. Because God knows that some people will not be smart. They will not have learned their lessons. And so they're going to sell their land. All right? Because they need money for something and something, so they'll sell their land to somebody, and then their children will be landless. So that their children will always have opportunity of ownership and something that is like an equity that he can use to start out whatever he wants to start out in life. All right. Even though sometimes it might be late, because if his father sold the land before he was born, you know, then they are going to wait, you know, for 50 years before the land is restored, and then he can now have his own portion, and then he can do whatever he wants to do with it if he has learned some lessons in financial literacy. You know, so God set this structure because God believes in ownership. So he said, make sure the land returns back to its owners. All right? So you have only bought it for the years of the harvest that it's going to give. You understand? So the principle is that the land is never totally and absolutely sold. If you buy it, you've only bought it for 50 years. So you pay the value before the next next Jubilee. So if Jubilee is 10 years from now and you are buying somebody's land, the person wants to sell his land to you, you can only sell 10 years of harvest. So you are not going to buy the same land somebody bought, you know, 1 year after Jubilee for 1 million naira. That same land, when it's 10 years to the next Jubilee, you can't pay 1 million. And nobody's going to pay you 1 million because they know in 10 years from now, the land is going to come back to you. You understand? Why? Because God believes in ownership. All right? Now, there is a transfer of wealth that is going on and which God wants to do on earth. And God wants you to be a part of it. And this transfer of wealth is going to come, you know, to us by God giving us stuff and helping us to do stuff that will cause wealth to come to us. It's not going to be a transfer of account to account. It's going to be a transfer of market to and this market to this person, this opportunity to this person, this open door to this person, this thing to this person, this idea comes to you, and you are the one that brings up the idea that really takes over the market and all of that. That's how the transfer of wealth is going to be. And this transfer of wealth is going to be because God believes in ownership. All right? And ownership happens these days in, you know, three different ways. You know, there are more, but primarily three. One, through investment. Two, through business building. You build business and then you see it happen, or you pick up a business that is dying and you repair it, and then you gain ownership. All right, because somebody is running the business down and then they can't run it anymore, so you buy it, you rebuild it, and it comes up, and then you turn it to, you know, a money making machine, you know, and all of that. So God is interested in ownership. You must get that at the back of your mind. Now, so we now look at this cash flow quadrants. And we want to start looking at a couple of things there. The first thing is this. There is an investor in you. And you must find that investor. All right? Very important. You must find that investor. You have to do a couple of things. Now, this is not a training for all of this, but we'll give you some tips that you can start working on. You have to, one, read about who an investor is, how investors think. Those two things are very important. Who is an investor? How do they think? Very important. Very, very, very important. There are habits that are, consistent among investors. You must find those habits. So don't forget what I said. Who is an investor? What does investor do? What are the habits? How does the investor think? And what are the habits? Those three you must find. Why? God wants you to be an investor. That's the ultimate. That's the ultimate. Now, you have to now find the type of investor you are. Some people, now, I believe very strongly that we can all invest in different things and make money from different things. But I believe also very, very carefully that there will be a particular area that fits with your gift, talent, you know, and all of that stuff, that you know that when you go in that field, you're able to pick the right things that will do well, and boom, you excel. Like I said the other time, a friend is investing in real estate. His friend is also trying to do that. But this guy is doing better in real estate than this other guy. Why? Because his wiring fits into that more. And this other guy is supposed to invest more in agriculture, you know, and then he's going to do very well in agriculture if he invests there. Now, there are certain fields that are failing in some nations, and that may be your area of strength, but God will open up something else that your wiring fits in. All right. So you have to find that. Very important. You have to pray about it. You have to seek concerning it. Why? Because there are so many other details that are involved. But it's like your character quality, your personality quality, your gifts, your aura, which is your special grace, your special favor. You understand? And certain energies from you just works well in a particular industry. All right. Like I said, you can invest in all areas and still do well with investment, but there are certain places where you just like a genius. It's like your star just breaks out and begins to shine. Why? Because in that place, it's just working. It's just working. It's just working. And some of us have some areas where you do something there, you leave it, you still come back to it, you still keep coming back to it because there's something there for you. That's why you keep coming back to it. So let's leave that. Now, when it comes to being a business person, which is also very important, there's a need to find a couple of things. One is you need to see clearly whether you're a visioner, some people call it visioneer, or you are in support. You are either wired as a visioner or visioning, or you're wired in support. Very, very important. All right? And you have to find which one you are so you're not struggling. There are people who are visionaries, who are playing the role of visionaries, but they are not visionaries. So they are trying to start something on their own, and there's so much struggling to just get it to go on, you know, because they are not visionaries. You know, they don't know how to create new things. So they look at what others are doing. So I can do that too. So they go and copy it. They are not original. They can be. Why? Because that's on their wiring. All right? Visioners are those who come up with ideas, create it, and they are ready to run with it. And there are visionaries that are architects. When I say architect, not architect as a profession, but they are people who conceive ideas and set it up and create it. But you see, to make it a thriving business, they don't have that. Because they are not entrepreneurial in their formation. Now, it's possible to learn entrepreneurial skills. Entrepreneurial skill sets can be learned. You understand? But it's not like when that is your natural wiring. When is your natural wiring? Oh, God, you're a genius. You just pick it up. You build it. It becomes a fantastic business making money. If it's just left to a visionary that is an architect, all he would do is create something that is beautiful, that can impact lives, change lives, and, you know, improve human existence and human, you know, having pleasure, you know, but he doesn't know how to turn it to money. And that's why a lot of times, I tell you this is very serious. A lot of times, things are failing with certain things and certain people, and it's just because they need to now look for. If I am a visioner, that's an architect visioner, I need to find an entrepreneur support system. Someone that is entrepreneurial in wiring, but is not a visionary, is a support kind of person. I need to bring that person along with me. If I bring in another visioner that is an entrepreneur, we're going to have some problems because at the end of the day, there's going to be a conflict of ownership. Why? Because he's a visioner. You know, because he's going to be coming up with some of his own ideas, which may not tally with my. I may be saying, no, you're doing what I said we should do. You are doing something different. Because the support doesn't create new ideas. He only knows what to do to maintain the good idea, to build the good idea, to keep running the good idea, to make the good idea, to keep doing what it's supposed to do. All right? But the entrepreneurial support is able to turn that good idea to money. He's not able to create any idea, but he can make that idea to continue to make money forever. And it's important for us to understand this. All right? So there are support people that are idea shapers. They can look at your idea and shape it out for you to be able to be more productive. There are support people that are into system building. They can build systems. Because when you want to build a business, you need systems, you need structures. We can also be trained in this. But there are some people that's just your natural. So when they get little information, oh God, they're like genius. They take those are the people that they see a company collapsing and they can look at that company and they can see structures that are bad that need to be fixed. They are looking at like they're seeing something in the spirit and they get in there and they put this here, put this there, put that there, shape this like this and turn this around. Then boom, the company begins to make money. Now, all of these things are very important. You need to know where you belong. You have to know where you belong. You have to understand precisely, okay, who am I? Looking at myself, am I a visioner? Am I support? Am I a visioner, architect, or am I an entrepreneurial visioner? Or do I have a combination of the actor and the entrepreneurial, you know? And all that is very important. Very, 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 very important. You know, very, very vital. Most of entrepreneurs are very high marketing skills. Most of the visionaries that are architects have zero marketing skills, but they can create great ideas, great companies, great innovation, great service, fantastic product. But how to get people to accept it, they don't know. But somebody knows how to get it to be accepted. Somebody knows how to put it in your table. Somebody knows how to put it in your face. Somebody knows how to make you to want that product, to like it, and then use it, and then become a user that keeps coming back for more. Somebody knows. Now, all this wiring, there's a need to begin to identify so I know where I belong. Because a lot of people are just there. See, the problem is this. We are told to go to school, get education, get a certificate, get out there, get a job, earn some income, get married, have your own family, buy a house, build one in the village. If you're a Nigerian, we build in the village, and then live a life, get old, have grandchildren, and die. And so we're all getting there to try and do that. So many times we are in the wrong place, doing the wrong things, running the wrong race. So most of the time, people are where they don't like. They go to offices they don't like. They are working where they are not passionate. They are working where they are not connected. So they are only struggling. And they don't want to leave the job because if they leave the job, they can't pay their bills. They have to pay house rent, mortgage on the house. They have to pay for the car, buy fuel, food. They have to survive. They call it the rat race. But there's the need to begin to identify yourself and then begin to identify your own qualities, the qualities that are uniquely you. And then begin to say, okay, this is where I think I belong. And then begin to migrate in that direction. Begin to navigate. Now, you don't need to leave your job otherwise, because don't go and say, Pastor Paul said I should move. You know, don't leave your job. Don't leave whatever you're doing now, whether you like it or you don't like it. But begin to identify where I truly belong. I might carve that to start something new. Then you are going to make up your mind that one day I'm going to start something new. I just have to accept it. That's who I am. I'm a visioner. Am I in support? Okay, I need to know that. Okay, am I a visioner as an architect? Okay, yeah. Somebody like me, that's what I am. I can have the best product in the world. I don't know how to sell it. I don't know how to get people to know they need it. So what do I need? I need a support entrepreneur. Someone that is able to say, okay, look, this thing, if we can put it like this, we can get it to touch many people, reach many people. And that's what I need. And these things help us to be able to run in the path that God has for us. Even if you're a professional, our profession normally wires us to start out practice. So you start a firm as a lawyer, you maybe start a hospital like as a doctor and all that. And then you are running that hospital and the hospital is just not doing well. And you're wondering what's going on, why you are very good, but you don't know how to run a business. Because the hospital is providing a service. Yes, the service is charity in nature, but also supposed to be a business. So, another doctor that is not as good as you starts his own hospital and boom, 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 boom. And you're wondering, I'm better than that guy. I have more results than him. In my area of specialty, I'm far, far, far better. How come? Why? Because he's building a business. Building a business. So these things are very important. I saw a situation one time where I saw one architect who had worked for some two big architectural firms in the US, started his own firm, you know, and tried for a number of years, couldn't do well. Then he came and joined one other guy that was a visionary in Nigeria. And this guy is so good, you know, he brought so much improvement to that other establishment because he was not a visionary. But because he was so good, he felt okay, he could just start something on his own. And he didn't do well. He didn't do well. Now, all these things I've said today, you need to prayerfully approach it so that you don't defy yourself and cage yourself. No, you must be able to carefully pray, you know, and say, God, I need to understand what exactly, what is it? And then you begin to build a network of relationship in areas, because where you are, that's who you are. Where you are not there. You have to find people that are there and join them to your team. And build teams together with them. And then you can make advancement. You can progress. You can run. You can go far. Very, very important. You know. And this is one of the things that helps. And then you have some people who are visionaries. They're architect visionaries. And they're also entrepreneurs in wiring. Or maybe they had a father that was an entrepreneur. So, you know, the man had kind of built the habits of an entrepreneur, some of the skill sets of the entrepreneur in his children. And these things count. They count greatly. It's time to find your path. It's time to find where you belong. It's time to begin to stand in the places that you are supposed to be in. If you are building a career, no problem with that. If your career is a purpose, pursue it, but become an investor too, all right? And then do something, build, and God will be doing amazing things in your life. I want us to pray briefly, and then we're going to take in questions, and then I will be able to help as much as I can. Father, thank you because you are merciful, gracious, and good. Thank you for your help. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your strength at all times. Thank you for the things you make happen. Thank you for the things that you do. I pray, Lord Almighty, that you help each one of these, your children, to be able to accurately discern who they are and be able to chart the path that you have for them. I'm asking, Lord, today that each one will begin to have their steps ordered into their right path in life. Those who peradventure have strayed, Lord, create that navigation, that GPS that locates them and connects them to where they're supposed to be. And Lord, help them to make that migration in the name of Jesus. And those who are already on the path, oh God, I pray that you help them to be more assured and to be able to flow in the path that you are for them. Thank you, faithful Father. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. All right. God bless you. We thank God for his mercies. If you have questions, this is the time to ask your questions. And if you want to ask by speaking, please raise your hand. Then you unmute your mic. And then you ask. I think we have an attendance something. I don't know whether that has been shared, but if it hasn't shared, please help us to click on the link and fill it. The attendance register has been shared. Yes, they've shared it. So please help us click on it and fill it so that we can send you more information. All right. And then we can help you also on these things that we're talking about. There's a transfer of wealth that is taking place, and it's going to happen speedily, all right, because God wants to move wealth into the hands of saints. In Europe, I've told you what God is doing. This is the place of the feet of the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw, Europe. And an extension of it is Canada, the U.S., and Australia. Most of the places where, I mean, South Africa is also an extension. In most of the places where the original Europeans, the Caucasians, have established their presence and made home. But physically is this place, continent of Europe. And that image is crumbling. And the stone that is crumbling it is you, the church. You are crushing it. You are taking it over. All right? We heard the other day, Disney was saying that they will still continue to push the transgender stuff to children, you know, even though, you know, thank God that the law went through in that particular state. But you see, that's the thing. We can't sit down as church and let that continue. We have to begin to make bold steps. Bold steps. Bold steps. Bold, bold, bold steps. You know, to take over places. In fact, the story of Twitter made me to see that you don't need to buy 80% of the company to take it over. You don't need to buy 50%. You know, if you get 12, 15%, in some cases, you have a hold and you can have a seat on the board, you know, and you need good money to do that. We need good money to take over pharmaceuticals. We need good money to venture into new inventions for healing, all right? There are many healing paths that God is making available that we need to invest in and find solutions. And we, the church, can bring out solutions without focusing on greed. Some of these pharmaceuticals are focused on greed, you know, and so some solutions that should be out there.